9:30 in the morning on Thursday morning, and I'm currently hiking my bike up an unrideable trail somewhere outside of Agadir in Morocco. I've been living on about 2.5-3 hours sleep the last 4 nights. Been wearing the same kit for the last 5 days. I smell terrible. Atlas Mountain Race. What an experience.
The Atlas Mountains, the largest and most formidable mountain range in northern Africa. 2,500 kilometers of peaks and valleys, gorges and plains, reaching from central Morocco, across Algeria, and into Tunisia. The range separates the Mediterranean and Atlantic coastlines from the deserts of the Sahara. It is not the kind of place one immediately thinks to ride a bike. My name is Tristan Cardew. I'm a photographer and cyclist from Sydney, Australia, now living in Girona, Spain. I've won races, trained with the world's top professional cyclists, and spend a majority of my year riding on the roads of Catalonia. I'd never considered doing an ultra until I heard about the Atlas Mountain Race, a 1,173 kilometer epic. It begins in Marrakesh and heads east into the mountains before heading south and west and finally finishing in Agadir on the Atlantic coast. 3 staffed checkpoints, very little resupply, and a fixed route adventure that grabbed my attention and wouldn't let go. This is my story of the Atlas Mountain Race 2022.
Alrighty, bon dia, and welcome to today's episode of Tristan Take Video. This is a super special one. The date is the 1st of October 2022, and today I'm in Marrakesh, Morocco, and I'm about to kick off the Atlas Mountain Race. Atlas Mountain Race is a gravel and mountain bike race that I got my entry to over 2 years ago now, and it's been postponed 3 times since. It was meant to go ahead in February 2021, and then it got postponed to October, then it got postponed February 2022, and now it's been postponed all the way through until October 2022, and today we have finally arrived. We start here in Marrakesh and we end in Agadir. Whenever you end in Agadir, it's a single stage race, so there's no specific spots where you need to stop. You just keep going and you stop whenever you like. Carry everything you need with you. It's unsupported. So I'm about to go and have breakfast. I'm about to get ready, and then I'm going to head off to the start line. I hope you guys enjoy this one. Let's go and do it.
First update.
34 kilometers in, I was about 8 kilometers in, just after the neutral when everyone started pushing, when I realized I hadn't turned my spot tracker on. So lesson number one that I've learned, I'm so not used to turning on a spot tracker. I do all the other things at the start of my ride usually, in a bit of a ritual or formula, and then I completely forgot to turn on the spot tracker. So I turned that on, but then it wasn't quite connecting to the internet. So I slowed right down to wait and ask just to make sure it was all good, and lost the group. So the group's pushed on. I've been on this bit of road by myself for a bit now. All good, still averaging like 28 Ks an hour, which going slightly uphill at 1% is not too bad. I'm gonna keep pushing on and update you soon. All right, so quick little update. 2.5 hours ride time, done 60 Ks. Was on some tarmac for quite a while, and then jumped onto the gravel, and then jumped back onto the tarmac, and then back onto the gravel. Some really nice gravel roads so far. I'm a bit annoyed with myself about screwing up the tracker thing at the start, because it meant that I missed the front group, and then I've kind of been picking guys off as I go along, but trying to keep my heart rate at a reasonable zone and not push too hard. But apparently the front guys are really pushing on, and there's about 15 of them or so. Now, I haven't looked at the dots, but yeah, I would have liked to have seen those guys go off so I knew where they were, who they were, and how far ahead they were going to be. But oh well, out here enjoying riding my bike, mid 20 degrees, we're at about 1,000 meters elevation. I'm 2170 meters. Holy shit, this climb is steep and loose, so brutal. To make matters worse, I'm going straight into a block headwind that's probably 20 Ks an hour. I can barely take my hands off the bars. It's just flattened out so I can film this. I'm gonna put my phone down again and keep climbing. Okay, pretty much at the top now. I seriously rank Tillouette Pass as the hardest thing I've ever done on the bike. That was unbelievable.
Hey man.
You.
Talking through your phone?
Yeah. Just talking about
crazy.
Just talking about how bloody hard it is. I literally did that entire climb probably at threshold watts. I don't have a power meter on my bike, but I seriously reckon I was at threshold watts and heart rate the entire way. I didn't walk. I genuinely rank getting up that without walking as one of the highlights of my bike riding career. Now comes the infamous walking goat track down the other side of Tillouette Pass. It's super windy. See why everyone was saying that day one is the most difficult. 119 k's in, come over the pass there. Now there's all the walking down this goat track on the other side. Some people can ride it, I definitely can't. Checkpoint one in 7 kilometers. Thank you.
checkpoint one coming up. Yeah, man. There's enough to annoy me.
Hello.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Yeah, that climbed the surface.
It was something else, all right.
There you go. Yeah.
Yes.
Cheers.
So Tristan, currently
you're still open.
Yeah. Yeah.
To 17. Got to get this on the
vlog. Everything on the table.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
All right.
Cool.
Okay,
thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Filled up with water, got a Coke, barely drank any, and now back on the road. I'm gonna aim for maybe kilometer 170 before I stop. Here because the sun is going down. It's 7 p.m. I've got 9 hours, 21 ride time, 144 k's. Come out of checkpoint one, tried to fill up as quick as possible. Didn't do a very good job, but first time, so whatever. Got it done and then got on my way. I was on a bit of a road for a while and then started up a climb. Have now ended up on a bit of a high plateau. Still climbing, as you can see. The reason I pull out my phone on the climbs is because it's just impossible on the descents. So, as I said, 9 hours 21. Feeling surprisingly good, hey? I'm quite surprised. At checkpoint one, my legs were starting to get a bit heavy and I had a protein shake. I've got four of the sachets with me for this race and I think that really, really helped. I've also been drinking a lot of carbohydrates today. Like a lot, like a majority of my bag is actually just full of carbohydrate powder. Haven't had any caffeine yet. I'm gonna keep riding for a while. The next stop is at kilometer 185. That's about 40 k's away. So I'm gonna keep riding to there, try and get some dinner, and then crack on a bit further, see where I get to, and maybe have a sleep at about 1 a.m. or so. Enjoying this a lot. Yeah, back to it. Is 8:47 p.m. Done 4,500 meters climbing, and I'm at about a column at 168. It's a bit of slow going at the moment. I was feeling really, really good along that flat section at the top of that little plateau, and then the road started getting rougher and rougher, and then we kind of headed down into this little canyon, and it got dark, as it does at night. That was no problem, but then we're getting smashed by this wind. I swear it was probably 40 kilometer an hour wind from directly in front and also slightly to the side. I almost got blown off my bike multiple times. There had been some pretty hectic clouds ahead and they were actually sending bolts of lightning into the sky. So I was a bit nervous that we were riding straight into it, which we pretty much were. And then it started raining. I stopped and put on a rain jacket and it was pretty grim for about 20 or 30 minutes. I was kind of near three other riders that have sort of been near all day. So we all stopped and put on a jacket at the same time, but then everyone kind of headed off and did their own thing. As I said, about kilometer 168 and heading for a town at kilometer 184. It's interesting, you know, because we sort of ride through these places and go to these places that people always say are the middle of nowhere. You know, right now I'm riding along and I was just thinking, far out, this is in the middle of nowhere and there's a town here. I'm riding through this small town and then it kind of dawns on me that, like, it might be the middle of nowhere to me, but to the people who live here, it's the center of their world. I find that idea super interesting. I just had to record that on video. Yep, another fucking storm. Heaps of rain this time. That ain't fun. I need to find a rock. Oh, yep. This'll do for a bit. Died down a bit. The rain's also died down. It's still raining, but I'm gonna jump back on the bike and press on, see if I can make it to that town in about 10k's time. Whew, see if I can do this. Jesus. This is cold. Wahoo, saying 7 degrees. Getting close to that town though. Merci, monsieur. Bonne nuit. Okay, just a quick update. It's about 3:30 in the morning. I'm at a very small town that I don't actually know the name of. It's literally not even on Google Maps. Last night I was riding along and I hid under that rock when it got real torrential, and I had my rain jacket on but I didn't have any leg warmers on, and because it was so windy and so rainy I didn't want to open my bag and take out my leg warmers. So I got really cold, but I wanted to push on the 10 kilometers to the next town, which was this one here. As I got to this town, there was a guy who was like a local authority. He was like sort of a policeman or like a townsman. He just like looks after this town. And he came up to me and he said, "Do you need help? Are you okay?" And I was like, "Yeah, yeah, I'm okay." And then I rolled off to the side to put on my, to put a base layer on and change clothes. And he was like, "Do you want us to get you a bed?" And so there's like a local, I guess it's kind of equivalent to like a hostel, but you don't pay for it, where they look after people. And me and a few of the other guys who were around at the same time, we all got a little bed here, had a couple of hours of sleep. The wind has been absolutely howling, but I'm so thankful to have this guy look after me. Yeah, so it's now 3:30 in the morning. I figure I may as well get out there and ride, even if it's 4 kilometers an hour into a block headwind. I'm gonna try and ride until breakfast time, get some breakfast, see what the wind's doing, and yeah, keep going on from there. Day one, what an experience so far. I'll see you out there.
Right.
Ciao. Alrighty, let's do this. Just a morning update. It is the second of October. It's a Sunday morning. I just stopped and had an omelette
after what's probably the most brutal 70 kilometers of my life. I rolled out this morning at 3:50, just straight into a headwind, probably like 30 to 40 k's an hour at times, doing 7 kilometers an hour going downhill. And then eventually it started to sort of lighten up, and I was onto this kind of weird moonscape looking area, which was really cool, but again, still really, really windy. Some really hard technical sections, which I just couldn't film because it's just too difficult to pull out my phone. And then the sun came up and it's just kind of this like white ball, so. Interesting morning. It's taken 5 hours to do 70 kilometers, so moving pretty slow. And now we go into the first of the 100 kilometer sections with nothing. So eating plenty of food, filled up with everything, and now I'm gonna do 100 Ks. Just really hoping the wind eases up because it's super taxing.
So the date is Friday the 16th of September. It's 2 weeks until Atlas. I've spent the last 48 hours with a bit of anxiety about this race. I'm a bit nervous. I met up with Zippy today, Zippy Doyle. He finished Badlands 2 weeks ago and he had a whole bunch of advice to give me about doing a big event like this. Now I know this sounds like pure ignorance, getting advice 2 weeks before a massive 1100 kilometer event, but I need all the help I can get at this moment. Trying to wrap my head around what's about to come. So thinking about it, I don't think it's actually the distance that's kind of making me anxious. The physical side of it, I feel like I've got down. It's more the mental side of doing something that you haven't done before in terms of being in the Moroccan desert, riding along with absolutely no one around, hoping that your bike doesn't fall apart or that your mind doesn't fall apart. I'm trying to make this as honest as possible. It's kind of a scary thought, you know. I don't know whether to be nervous or excited, or I guess there's a bit of both right now, so.
This is gonna be interesting. Fun. That's the best part of the course so far. Stops. At least the views are good though. Alright, we're reduced to walking. You can't tell how steep this is, but this might be harder than yesterday's path. So rocky, heaps of sections above like 18-20%. I'm exhausted.
feeling super, super exhausted. I'm gonna pull my pillow out, set my alarm for 20 minutes, lie down on this thing here, have a nap. Little tip, always bring an eye mask. Had that tucked in my pocket. Had a great little sleep, now to get up and crack on. All right, sleep out the way. Time to get this last 38 kilometers done of the 100 kilometer section. Go and grab some food. Little update while I got a chance. Where did I leave off? Okay, so we went up that big steep mofo of a climb. It was so steep and so rocky, super brutal. I was cooked when I got to the top. So I rolled down the other side, and as I was descending, I started to get a little bit sort of wobbly. So I was just like, you know what, I'll lie down and have a little sleep. So I napped for 20 minutes and then got up. Kept riding, had that amazing scenery when we were up on the plateau there. Insane, definitely the best scenery so far. And I was just loving flowing down that descent on the mountain bike. It goes so well. Again, I cannot imagine trying to do this race on a gravel bike. It's so enjoyable with dual suspension and fat tires. And then just stopped and had a little bit of basically what is gonna be dinner, which is a few cans of tuna, had a protein shake. And now it's about 7 o'clock, so official sunset is in about 20 minutes. Today's been real weird. It's just been kind of gray all day. Like you barely really saw the sun at all. Sort of did see it, but it was just like this weird gray sky. Anyway, I'm gonna ride off into the night here. Done about 3,500 meters climbing. So yeah, chuck my headlights on and ride into the dark. All right, so the date is Wednesday, September 21. I've got 8 days until I leave for Atlas, and it's testing time. Now, my mountain bike hasn't arrived yet, so I'm riding the gravel bike out here, and what I've done is I've packed up my bike with bags, and I've got probably about 80% of the things that I'm carrying with me that I'm planning on taking to Atlas. I'm doing a little overnighter. I'm not focusing on the riding component. I'm focusing on the overnight component, doing the practice of having my sleeping system, getting it out in the dark, setting it up, and then packing it up as quick as I can in the morning and keeping on riding. That's the focus for today. Super beautiful afternoon out here. I'm just in Girona. I'm doing a gravel ride that I know it's not super, super rough. The aim is just to cruise along, practice pedaling with not a lot of watts, and then finding a spot to set up, setting up, sleeping the night, and then keeping on going in the morning. So a little update after the last couple of hours. I've been riding into the Gavaris trails here in Girona, just letting it get darker and darker and darker. As I said before, this ride is not necessarily about the actual bike riding component and more just about riding until it gets dark, finding a spot to pitch my sleep system and getting some sleep. I've ridden into the dark before, but by myself in the jungle, in the forest, it's an interesting little experience. I'm sure this will bode well for me come the nighttime in Morocco in 10 days time. Monday morning, the third, day three of Atlas Mountain Race. Currently out on this road, out somewhere near Algeria, I think. It's 7:10 in the morning, so sunrise is in 10 minutes. Although it looks like it's gonna be another sort of gray day.
it's weird. It's like not grey cloudy, it's like grey dusty or something. Anyway, it gives the landscape this kind of eerie look. I've been out here for a couple of hours now already in the dark. Just turned off my lights. Last night I rode up this massive road climb that seems to last for ages. And then I got to the top of that and it was about 1 o'clock in the morning. And just as I was coming through this town, there were these couple of young guys and they pointed a light at me and kind of waved me over, and they were actually, they had a little hotel and restaurant and they were open at 1 o'clock in the morning, and the guy said, "Do you want a tagine?" And I was like, yeah. I was so tired I didn't take any video of it. So I ate a little bit of food there. And then I lay down on the floor and I slept for about an hour and a half, 2 hours. And then I got up and got out and yeah, so I'm out here now. I'm pretty tired, not quite even at the halfway mark, but that's my aim for today. Oh yeah, and the other reason that it was quite good to stay in that little place, even if just on the floor, was that it gave me a chance to charge a couple of things. I'm gonna do a bigger breakdown of everything I brought and how I managed all my power and batteries and things like that in a video coming soon. So if you haven't subscribed to the YouTube channel, please do subscribe, because I'm gonna do a couple of follow-up videos about my experience, what I brought and what I learned. If you are thinking about doing an ultra race like Atlas Mountain or stuff like that. Alright, another update, kilometre about 499 now. Just had this mad descent on that gravel road, so sick. You could do that on a gravel bike, but on the dually I could just absolutely let loose, it was so nice. And then popped onto a road for a little while and I started getting really, really tired. I was actually almost starting to nod off on the bike. The road was just too smooth. And then came into a town called Tasnacht, which was actually quite a big town, and I sat and I had a couple of crepes, a couple of coffees, and now I got my full game face on. I had a look at where my dot is. I think I'm currently 14th at the moment, so I'm just trying to chase down, go as far as I can. I really wanna see what I can do over the next 2 days.
So, what the fuck? There was a perfectly rideable trail just there, which is just over there. You know what we have to go through? This. How is this? How did they come up with this as a course? This is ridiculous. This is more mentally taxing than physical. Got a Red Bull here just in case. Plenty of water. Having a fucking shocker. For some reason, the big Wahoo just decides to just cut out after like 13 hours. It just doesn't recognize the GPS anymore, and so the speed just like comes to a dead stop and it just says zero. And I've got my backup Wahoo and that one can't find the GPS, so not in a good mood. On top of that, the route itself just has some absolutely fucking stupid parts to it where it tells you to go off onto like some crappy riverbed, and then you're riding along the riverbed and then all of a sudden the route's
on the trail that you were just on, and you've like hiked down into the riverbed, and then you got to hike back up. I don't know if that's like a GPS fuck up, a Komoot fuck up. Nelson's just planned the route to be annoying. It's so tiring though, it's so taxing. I don't mind a bit of hiker bike, I don't mind a bit of adventure, but this is just the kind of shit that you're just like, what is this shit? Yeah, that's enough swearing. My Wahoo's got GPS now, so I guess I better keep riding.
Cardboards for the win.
It's Sunday, 25th of September. I'm leaving on Thursday, so I've got 5 days to go until I leave. I've got 4 days to go until I leave. I'm about to go and pick up my bike now, my new bike that I'm going to be riding. I'm so fucking nervous, hey. Like, the race doesn't even start for a week, and I cannot stop thinking about it. My anxiety is through the roof. I'm dreaming about it every night, and as soon as I wake up, that's all I'm thinking about. It's not the riding part. I think I'll be okay for the riding part. It's just the sleeping and the eating and... I can't even think straight. I better go and pick up the bike. So I'm on my way to pick up my bike. The Sea Otter Girona bike show is happening in Girona this weekend. So what I'm doing is I'm heading over to the BMC stand at the Sea Otter. It's really, really epic of BMC to lend me a demo bike for this event. About 2 years ago, when I got the entry for Atlas Mountain Race, I was like, God, I'm gonna need to get a mountain bike. And every time it's been postponed, I've thought, okay, that gives me a bit more of a chance to get the mountain bike. And finally, because it's going ahead, I reached out to BMC and they decided that they would help me out with a mountain bike. So I'm about to go and pick up my mountain bike for this event. It's a dual suspension bike. I'm gonna show you in a moment. I'm pretty excited about it. I'm trying to calm my nerves, but I think a mountain bike is the best option for this race.
Sick, thanks, man.
Cheers. Alrighty, so I've just come home from the Sea Otter. Calmed my nerves a lot. I've picked up my new bike, as you can see here. This bike is a BMC 4-stroke LT, a 120mm dual suspension mountain bike. Now, if you think it's a bit like bringing a bazooka to a gunfight, it is. It's an absolute beast. And from everyone I've spoken to about Atlas Mountain Race before going, they've all said this is a good idea. The reason why is even though Atlas is classed as a gravel race, it's so, so rough and rocky that having a dual suspension bike just makes sense. Mountain bikes these days are so, so efficient at pedaling. They're not like bikes back in the day where you're at a real weight disadvantage and a suspension disadvantage because of the bobbing of the suspension. These days you can lock the suspension out. On this 4-stroke that I'm running, you can actually lock it out halfway. So you can have a sort of semi-lockout, which is amazing for pedaling efficiency. I don't know if anyone else in the race is gonna be running a bike this big. And although right now I'm a little bit nervous for dragging this thing across 1100 kilometers of gravel road and off-road terrain, I'm hoping that it does the job really well. I'm gonna take it out for a spin shortly and go and give it a test. Yeah, that's what I got. I'm super pumped. So I'm out for my first ride on the new BMC 4-stroke that I just picked up like 2 hours ago. I've had quite a lot of
anxiety around this, around getting this bike so close to the event and having enough time to test it. So I picked it up from the guys at the BMC stand. They had the demo bike there for me. They bought it straight from Switzerland. So I said hey to the guys there. They passed me the bike, set it up for me a bit, shock pressure and things like that. I brought it home. I've had a good hard look at it. I've also whacked on the bags. I packed my bags with about 90% of what I'm taking. I'm just missing a very few small things. One of the things I can say straight up, I've just rolled out of Girona up a steep little climb. I'm climbing up like 15, 16, 17% pinches here and it's so comfortable. It's incredible. I think this is a really good decision to go for a dual suspension bike. It just sort of tracks the ground really well, especially when climbing, and also the gearing. I'm running 34 on the front and 50 on the back, so I can get up anything really.
Monday afternoon, Monday evening, I think. Been out here 2.5 days. Done 640 Ks and about 12,000 meters climbing. I'm really fucked. I've slept about 4.5 hours total in the last 2.5 days. My fingers have lost a bit of feeling in them. My wrist is super fucked. I like can't move my thumb properly without my wrist absolutely killing me, which really sucks when the shifter's right there and you need your thumb to shift the gears. I've got about 20 or 30 Ks to go until I reach checkpoint 2. I'm gonna get there. Then there's about 520 Ks to the finish line. I'm gonna have to pull something special out of the bag to get this one done. Let me ride into the night. I'll see how I'm feeling in a couple of hours. Yep, that's exactly what I want. The Wahoo's just switched off. I have to wait for it to recover that ride. See where I'm missing, where I'm going, and then try and get there. Multi-day rides, man. Absolutely brutal. All right, so I'm still on the right route, which is basically just this climb over a pass or something down to the checkpoint. Let me keep going. Day 3, the brutal one. Let's hope tomorrow's better.
It's really fucking hard, but I really want to get it done. I'll message you when I get internet again, okay? I love you. Bye.
What a day. What a day. What a last 24 hours. One of the most interesting, emotionally taxing, fascinating, painful, really, really painful, emotionally damaging days of my life. Morocco is leaving some pretty interesting marks on me. At least the sunlight's nice right now. It's good views. Just under 400 kilometers to go. I can't wait to get there. Morning update for you. It's okay, it's Wednesday morning. 3 days and 23 hours since I started, left Marrakesh. The last 36 hours have probably been, I've gone into like the darkest places I've ever been. My wrist is so sore that I can't move my thumb. I can just hold the handlebars. Every time I go over a bump, it sends like a shockwave through my hand and my arm. I can't sit down properly, so I have to stand up, but that means that I have to use my wrist. The road is so, so cracked and so uneven that I have to shift, but every time I shift, it hurts even more. I almost scratched two nights ago. I just had Mike's words in my head. Many a race campaign have been saved on a good night's sleep. The thing that fucked me up real bad was that I got to checkpoint 2 and I thought it was a GPS error, and I kept going and I went an extra 10Ks down the road, which included a descent that's the steepest descent I've ever been down in my life. And I got to the bottom and I was looking around for checkpoint 2 where I thought it was meant to be, and I realized that it was back at the spot that I had stopped out the front of, but I hadn't seen any sign or anything, any indication it was a checkpoint, and so I'd kept rolling. And so I had to climb back up that steep climb at about midnight with my wrist killing me, and I was so close. I was so close to scratching. At the time, I think it was about position 16, and I just had to tell myself, throw the idea of competing out the window. Now it's about surviving. I woke up in the morning. I couldn't bring myself to speak on camera. All I could do was get ready slowly with my wrist and put everything back in my bag. And then yesterday was just up and down roller coaster. I rolled out at 10 a.m. and every single thing seemed to be going wrong. When I turned my Wahoo on, even though it had 40% battery the night before, it said it was at 1%, and then I pulled out my spare Wahoo. I turned that on, and that was also at 1%, and I couldn't believe it, that I have two Wahoos, both that were meant to be at 40 or 50%, and somehow overnight, even though they were switched off, they drained to 1%. So I felt like everything was against me yesterday morning. So I spent a majority of the morning in tears, thinking that that might be race over, with 500Ks to go. But this has been 2 years coming, and I refuse to let the race beat me. I don't give a fuck what it throws at me. I really, really want to get through this. I refuse to let it beat me. So I rolled up a climb, over a climb, stopped in a little kind of, not even a shop, but just with a local guy and also with another rider.
and just had some yogurt and some dates and then kept going. It was really hot. It was like 35 degrees. Then up and over another climb. The entire day my wrist was killing me. The entire day I was so, so sore. But as I ticked off the Ks, I kind of started to come around and then I started to claw back a few places. And then I finished the day on a road with a really, really nice sunset and then pushed on into the night. I wanted to get as far as I could. And then last night, I finally decided that it was time to pull myself together and get this thing done. And so now, as you can see, it is about 7:45 in the morning. The sun's coming up behind me. I've got this small little pass to go, a big descent off that, get some breakfast, two big climbs, still about 350 Ks to go, but I'm feeling like I can do this in one go. I think that the end is in sight. I really hope the end is in sight. I can't wait to be in Agadir. So where did you sleep?
There was a place 10 kilometers far where there was a nice sun passage. And I thought, if this continues till here, I will be my breakfast in half an hour. Oh, but it took 1.5 hours.
And then what time did you get here?
9.
9, okay. What time is it now?
9:30.
9:30.
Did you
get up? I didn't get up until 6. Kilometer 850. The climb that I went over last night, I thought that I could get over and down the other side in about 5 or 6 hours, and it was about 60 Ks long. And the climb up had sections of road that just ended, and you had to climb down into a crevice and drag the bike up the other side back onto the road. This old colonial piece, it was wild. It was so rocky. I ended up having to hike for large portions of it, just walk with the bike. So I was averaging like 2.5 Ks an hour for like certain sections. So the stars were out, the moon was out. So I was able to turn off the lights and just walk. But then I got near the top of that and I just thought, you know what? I need to sleep. I'm not gonna be able to go any further. It's too battering on my body. So I set up my bivvy and I slept and then got up this morning thinking I just had the descent to do. And the descent, which was only about 15 kilometers, took me, I don't know, maybe an hour and a half, 2 hours, just getting thrashed around. It was just as hard descending as it was climbing, even on a full suspension bike. Kudos to the guys who did it on the gravel bikes. I'm really, really over it now. I'm having a hard time with my wrist. It's no worse than it was yesterday, but it's definitely no better. Anyway, it sounds like that old colonial piece that we just did, that 60K stretch, that was the hardest of the whole race. So I feel like being outside the other side of that, and now onto this road where I've just had an omelet in the next town. Now I'm off for 100 Ks of nothing and over another big climb. It's about 150 Ks to checkpoint 3. I really want to try and get there by tonight. All right, figured out I'm kilometer
930 or so. So there's about 60 to go to the next checkpoint, about 40 to the next town. Just had a small stop in a spot that wasn't actually on the list of resupply points. Luckily there was a shop there though, so I could have a drink and fill up my water bottles and everything again. It was a big day, but I'm motivated to get to checkpoint 3, and then I'm motivated to keep going after I get there so I can put another 50 Ks into the final 170 or whatever that's left. I've had three big climbs in the last 2 days. Really, really big climbs. Like these like climbs that take a couple of hours each, if not more. The one last night just went forever. Hiking, climbing, trying to ride. It was so rocky. I've just got one left. It's about 800 meters up from where I am at the moment. I'm at about 1,000 meters here, and the top is at 1,800, but it's got a descent in the middle of it towards the top, so I'm probably got about another 1,000, 1,200, 1,500 meters of climbing. Up this climb now, then down the other side to the next town, then to the checkpoint. Getting there, I can feel the end in sight. My wrist is killing me, but I'm motivated by some messages that you guys have been sending me, and also just the idea of an ice cream at the finish line. That is the third climb out the way. I think we're about to go into a beautiful big road descent at sunset. This is perfect. Check this out.
That was short-lived. I guess Nelson being Nelson and Atlas Mountain Race being Atlas Mountain Race means that it was never going to be straightforward. I got 20 k's to the checkpoint. Got to hike through a bush to get there. So good. Oh, that feels so damn good. 34 hours to get from checkpoint 2 to checkpoint 3. 330 kilometers.
Massive feed.
All right, so it's Wednesday night. It is the final night for me of the Atlas Mountain Race. I did 190 kilometers earlier today, and now I've just left checkpoint 3 and I'm heading for the finish line. 170 k's to go, and a few road climbs from what I understand, some mountain bike single track stuff, and then the finish line in Agadir. Today was pretty epic actually. My wrist started feeling better and better over the course of the afternoon. It's not perfect, definitely can't shift easily, but at least I can hold the bars more comfortably now. And then when I got to the finish line at checkpoint 3 just then, had a big feed of some food, sat with a couple of guys, wasted a bunch of time waiting for my Wahoo to charge, and a lot of other guys who actually got to checkpoint 3 after me left before me. So this is a good learning lesson for me. One of the big things that this shows is that bikepacking races are less about how well you ride your bike and much more about how well you manage your overall time. My riding speed has been quite quick, but my overall time has been quite slow just because of the amount of stopping and faffing that I do with my bike bags and eating. And anyway, I'm on to the final stage. I'm gonna crack through this, try and stay up all night because I haven't pulled an all-nighter yet. Get to the finish line in Agadir. Aiming for around 5 days. See how I go. This is so goddamn hard. This is like 12% loose rocks. Pushing the bike. Still got 80 k's to go to the finish. In my hopes of getting there by 9 a.m. getting slim.
I've just got no more energy left to give. This has taken every single bit of energy out of me.
Be my last update before I roll out. The day is Friday, the 30th of September 2022, and in the morning Atlas Mountain Race 2022 starts. I have been on such an emotional roller coaster the last few weeks trying to get ready for this event, and my biggest emotion around this has been one of anxiety and fear. But now I've made it to Morocco, my bike's built, I did registration today, I went to the rider briefing, I got my brevet card. And I'm sitting out here on the balcony with the view of Marrakesh and the view of the Atlas Mountains in the background. And the overwhelming feeling that I have at this moment is one of peace. And after so much thinking about it and so much stress, to get here and feel this way feels really, really nice. So I hope whatever happens, it's exciting. I hope to get through in one piece. And I hope you guys have enjoyed this journey with me. Tomorrow it's time to go and ride my bike. And I'll see you guys in another episode soon. See the stamp on this thing. You're an evil bastard, hey?
I've had some moments.
Well done.
Cheers, man.
Well done.
Get that stamp. Oh, yeah. Cheers. Thank you very much.
Congrats.
Thanks, dude.
Thanks for putting on such a great race.